More than 5,000 movies have come and gone since the decade began, and Michael and I have each come up with 10 that we think will stand the test of time. Starting today and continuing over the next 9 weeks, we'll be counting them down. At number 10 on my list is Million Dollar Baby. No American director has had a better run over the last 10 years than Clint Eastwood. Of all the great movies he's made, this is the one that stands out for me. Eastwood won a Best Picture Oscar for this simple, spare, potentially corny story about an aging boxing trainer named Frankie Dunn who takes on an eager young fighter played by Hilary Swank. She won her second Oscar for this role.
Mr. Dunn?
I owe you money.
No, sir.
I know your mama.
Thought you might be interested in training me.
I don't train girls.
People see me fight, say I'm pretty tough.
Girly, tough ain't enough.
Million Dollar Baby is devastatingly sad, and it has an understated beauty, thanks to Tom Stern's cinematography, Eastwood's aching score, and the unadorned, gimmick-free way he tells the story. It's hard to believe that this movie came out only 5 years ago. It has the feeling of a classic that's been around forever.
Well, I think it's consciously trying to feel like a classic, but you mentioned potentially corny. I think this film fully realized that potential, because to me, all it is a well-acted melodrama with nothing else in it. I think the role that Hilary Swank's valiantly fighting to make into a three-dimensional human being is nothing but Saint Joan of the Ozarks. He's done work as good as Letters from Iwo Jima this decade. Why this film? I don't get it.
Why this film? Because this film takes what is a conventional Hollywood story, takes, you know, one of the oldest genres in the book. This movie, in a way, could have come out in 1934 as easily as 2004, and it breathes new life into it. It's like watching a great musician perform a standard from the American songbook.
When you look at Unforgiven, A Perfect World.
Stop changing the subject.
Bridges from Madison County, you want to talk about Korn transcended. You know, beautiful film. This is nowhere near there. So
I think you're wrong.
Not every director represented on my best of the decade list has the reputation, the resume, or, let's be honest, the erratic results of the creative force behind my number 10. But Steven Spielberg's Minority Report, released in 2002, is one of the director's great and most underrated achievements.
Hey, Jed, what's coming?
Red Ball, double homicide, one male, one female. Killers male, white, 40s.
Time frame?
13 minutes.
All right, Howard Marks, where are you?
That's, of course, Tom Cruise, whose supernatural intensity is very well suited to the role of a detective in Washington, D.C.'s pre-crime division. Now, thanks to a trio of psychics, murders in this world can be prevented in most cases just before they happen. Minority Report throws us headlong into that world that has gone way past George Orwell. And with Minority Report, Steven Spielberg's made what I think is the coolest, coldest film noir to come out of contemporary Hollywood. This film, a second time, it holds up beautifully, I think.
It's beautiful. It goes a little soft at the end. It kind of lets this world off the hook in a way that undermines some of what's come before. But the visual texture is extraordinary. Yeah. I mean, there are very few filmmakers who can blend CGI special effects with classical cinematic techniques quite as well as Spielberg can.
And this is a very morally unsettling world. Yes, you know, Spielberg, I think, is not just enamored with the technology. He's really kind of warning us against the excesses
of it. What's great, too, is that he immerses us in it rather than kind of explain everything. Yeah. It's all the exposition is on the run. It's a chase movie.
Yeah, I agree. Last Half Hour, not great.
It's a Spielberg movie.
I don't care. I don't care. The best of it is terrific.
Now we move on to number 9. With my pick, I had to make sure I wasn't being sentimental about a legendary director, but Robert Altman's Gosford Park is a singular and marvelous diversion, a murder mystery with an almost cosmically impressive all-star ensemble. From behind his ever-slippery, slip-sliding camera, he cast a net over a host of Agatha Christie archetypes. Now, two scenes for me point out Gosford Park's greatness. One is an encounter between two veteran actresses that completely changes the emotional temperature. Comes late in the film, and it's one of the most nakedly emotional scenes in all of Altman. Here's the other scene I cherish.
I shall never be your king, nor you shall be my queen. Days may pass and
that's Jeremy Northam as matinee idol Ivor Novello serenading his hosts. And this scene is Altman at his best, capturing human behavior and reactions, not just actors playing their parts, as if he'd just happened upon them by accident. This film, I think, is just lovely.
It's wonderful. It's a gem. It's kind of the, I think of it as the film that Merchant and Ivory were trying and failing to make for more than 20 years. Because when Altman steps out and does period, which is fairly rare, he does have exactly that kind of sense that you talk about of capturing
human behavior as it's happening. You really feel like you're in the midst of this movie. The plot is so much less important than the atmosphere, the environment,
the
web of relationships.
You're used to seeing this sort of murder mystery, this Agatha Christie, Dorothy Sayers thing, filmed very kind of like head-on, four-square, and just to see Altman kind of creating the atmosphere and like moving things the way he does. His mosaic sense is wonderful.
The plot is just completely offhand.
Good
pick. My pick for the ninth best film of the past 10 years is one that I underestimated when it first came out. It's Spike Lee's 25th Hour, based on a novel by David Benioff, who wrote the screenplay. I liked the movie well enough, but I left it off my 2002 10 best list. In the years since, I've found myself coming back to it again and again. Some of this has to do with the texture of the filmmaking, the music, the imagery, Lee's almost free associative way of telling a complicated story about friendship, betrayal, and manhood. Edward Norton is excellent as Monty Brogan, a mid-level drug dealer enjoying his last day of freedom before heading to prison upstate.
Champagne for my real friends. And real pain for my sham friends.
Cheers.
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 Philip Seymour Hoffman and Barry Pepper are also terrific as Monty's boyhood pals. But what makes this movie stand out is its evocation of New York in the months just after September 11th.
You gonna move?
What are you talking about?
As much good money as I pay for this place? Hell no. Tell you what, Bin Laden could drop another one right next door. I ain't moving.
A lot of filmmakers have tried to address 9/11 in various ways, direct and indirect, but none has captured the mood of the city and the rest of the country quite as well as Spike Lee did in 25th Hour. It's one of those movies that gets better and richer every time you see it.
A good film, very well acted.
It improves over time. It really does.
I'm not sure. When I saw it again just the other week, I wasn't as convinced as you are that the 9/11 material, which was layered on top of a story,
it was not in the original.
Right. I'm not convinced it really completely works together, but you know, Edward Norton is an actor for me that really is one of the most valuable guys of the decade. I mean, in so many different films.
See, it's interesting. I'm not a huge Edward Norton fan. I love this performance. I think he just nails it completely.
Well, I agree with you partly.
My number eight pick is a love story, a very unusual one, and perhaps the most memorable movie ever made on the subject of forgetting. It's Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, a product of the visual wizardry of director Michel Gondry and the restless, omnivorous imagination of screenwriter Charlie Kaufman.
You're not a stalker or anything, right?
I'm not a stalker. You're the one that talked to me, remember?
That is the oldest trick in the stalker book.
Really? There's a stalker book?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I gotta read that one.
An amazingly subdued Jim Carrey plays Joel, a mopey fellow, smitten with a charming waif named Clementine, played by Kate Winslet, who breaks his heart so bad he'll do anything to get her back, or maybe just to erase her from his mind. Eternal Sunshine creates its own world, in which a mad scientist runs a memory-wiping business, and where reality seems as unpredictable as human emotions. It's sad, it's funny, it's loaded with brilliantly puzzling ideas and full of real and powerful feeling.
Tony, I'm glad to see your list going in the correct direction.
Oh, you approve of my taste.
Yes, finally, I was wondering. It's improving as we go down the list. No, I think this is a very good film, very good film. And I think Charlie Kaufman is one of the great auteurs of the whole decade. He has been writing unbelievable stuff
in adaptation, being
John Malkovich, and though it's a difficult film and not entirely successful, Synecdoche, New York,
it's a terrific movie, and he's
always dealing with really what it means to be alive and what it means to have a heart, you know, and I think he's doing it in a way that is so witty and so smart, and I just find it very moved, and it's really grounded.
I mean, these movies are crazy and go in all kinds of weird directions, but they're always grounded in real feeling and in real problems.
And at their core, they're very serious. Yeah. Recapping my list so far, I had Minority Report at number 10, Gosford Park at number 9. My number 8 pick for the top 10 of the decade is David Lynch's Mulholland Drive, which tells the twisty, reality-bending story of a sunny young actress from Deep River, Ontario, who travels to Hollywood to try her luck in the movies. First day in town, she meets a sultry femme fatale who has survived both an attempt on her life and a car accident, but she's an amnesiac with no clue as to her identity.
This is your purse. Your name must be in your purse. You want to know, don't you? Yes, but open it.
That's Laura Elena Haring with the fantastic Naomi Watts as Betty, a character who isn't who she seems either. As we follow these stories, the film grows more and more hallucinatory, and by the two-thirds point, you've lost all your bearings, but in a wonderful way. The film was expanded from a TV pilot rejected by ABC, and like Lynch's Twin Peaks,
I think this one probably would have had a hard time sustaining its trance-like quality, but the way Mulholland Drive turned out, it's a timeless, voluptuous, and fabulous puzzle with no single solution. Tony, this, for me, right up there with Eraserhead, Blue Velvet, this is his third great masterwork.
You know, I liked it the first time I saw it. I think that this is one of these movies that gathers a kind of a critical sort of cult of personality around it.
I don't care what anybody else thinks about it.
I don't think that it actually does hold up or repay repeated viewings. I think that there's beautiful stuff in it. There are haunting images. There are a lot of fascinating kind of creepy Freudian implications in the way that there usually are with David Lynch.
Right.
But I think that it just kind of wanders. I don't think that it sustains a tone or an air of mystery, and I don't think, unlike Eternal Sunshine, I don't think that it's really in the end grounded in an interesting psychological or emotional
apples and oranges,
set of
apples and oranges. And I think you're just trying to, you wish it was a different kind of movie altogether. For me, it's a dream that works.
Well, for me, it's a dream that I wake up and forget all about.
And now for this week's pick, number 7 is United 93. It's written and directed by Paul Greengrass, and it dramatizes one of 4 flights hijacked by members of Al-Qaeda on September 11th, 2001. The terrorists intended to crash land either into the White House or the nation's capital. The plane never got there.
Stewardess, listen to me. Are you listening?
I'm listening.
Go back and you get everything. Get every weapon you can. Get whatever we can use as a weapon.
What are we gonna do?
We'll figure that out, but get every weapon we can.
Now, without sacrificing clarity for cheap thrills, Greengrass puts you right in the middle of the chaos, darting from the terrorists to the passengers to the flight controllers to the military. You cannot watch this film casually. It's not even a film I chose to see a second time until recently, but to anyone who skipped it when it came out in 2006, I say it is time, and the film is both harrowing and honorable. Tony, you?
I agree. It's harrowing and honorable, and it's a technical tour de force. Paul Greengrass is an amazing filmmaker. Made 4 very good movies in this decade: Bloody Sunday, the 2 Bourne movies that he did, and this one. But I think this is kind of the weakest one, and it shows
of those 4?
Not because of the craft or the technique, but because this story shows the limitations of that kind of immersive quasi-documentary filmmaking. I just don't think that there's, in a way, enough of the meaning and aftermath of 9/11 in there. It almost, when it came out, people said it was too soon. It felt to me like it was too late, and it was almost oddly nostalgic.
No. I think the narrow perspective and this sort of ruthless focus on what happened, it's like a procedural, and I think it's just what this film needed. And I think, you know, you're absolutely right about Greengrass's technique. It's amazing how well it works in the Bourne ultimate and the Bourne Supremacy, and you know, to me, he's a master filmmaker.
I don't know, it's just not quite enough for me.
Mm.
Okay, recapping my pick so far, at number 10, I have Million Dollar Baby, number 9, 25th Hour, at 8, Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind. Now, my number 7 pick. Every so often, a great movie seems to come out of nowhere. Of course, Romania is not really nowhere, but critics who went to see a Romanian movie with the strange title 4 Months, 3 Weeks, and 2 Days on the first morning of the Cannes Film Festival in 2007 were not necessarily expecting to be blown away by what they saw. But we were, and the movie, directed by Cristian Mungiu, went on to win that festival's top prize.
Știi, zic altfel. Stai tu liniștită că o să fie totul bine. Nu te stă atunci numărul.
Știți că odată ce am dat drumul, mai e care de întors.
432 takes place in Bucharest in the mid-1980s. It follows 2 college students through a single harrowing day and night. One of them is accidentally pregnant, and her friend is trying to help her get an abortion, something completely illegal in Romania at that time. This film is unnerving and also amazing. It's as suspenseful as Hitchcock and as smart, humane, and unsentimental a movie as any I've ever seen.
Yes, yes, this film almost made my top. Yes, yes, this film almost made my top 10 of the decade, and that really does say something. I mean, think of how many thousands the movies we're talking about. Romania has had this unbelievable kind of golden age
of young filmmakers in their 30s.
And look, most people in America have not seen these works. Right. I mean, you can throw out titles like The Death of Mr. Lazarescu, 4 Months, 3 Weeks, 2 Days, and this is new territory for most people, but they should seek this film out.
It is really worth seeking out, absolutely.
And now my number 6 pick, David Fincher's Zodiac, which came out in 2007. And struck me at that time as an exceptional true crime picture. Now, though, it seems more than that. The film examines the case of the Zodiac serial killer murders around San Francisco in the late 1960s and 70s. The violence in the film all comes in the first third. The rest deals with characters played by Jake Gyllenhaal, Robert Downey Jr., Anthony Edwards, and Mark Ruffalo as they track their elusive quarry.
Does one do that?
I like puzzles. I do them a lot.
Got any hard suspects?
About 90 an hour. Come up to around 500.
You got four crime scenes. Not a single usable print. You can't think of this case in normal police terms.
Most thrillers built around scenery-chewing serial killers, like the ones in No Country for Old Men or The Silence of the Lambs, tend to score with audiences and Oscar voters, certainly more so than a brooding symphony of frustration and paranoia like Zodiac. So be it. Fincher's film is a singular testament to loose ends never to be tied. This film, very haunting.
It sort of settles into your bones like a damp chill. And it's one of the great evocations of just a kind of atmosphere of dread. It's not even the killer himself, as you say. It's just this sort of, this feeling that it's kind of in the air, in the fog of San Francisco. It's also, I think, a milestone in the incorporation of digital and CGI effects into realist filmmaking. Yeah. Most directors use those effects for fantasy and magic. Fincher uses it to create a period atmosphere, right, of San Francisco in the
70s. And every digital effect in this picture, in almost every shot, you know, it's meant to be invisible. All you're doing is getting closer and closer to the period itself. Yeah. And it's masterly filmmaking.
Good pick.
Thank you. Very gracious of you to say so.
So far, my picks for the best movies of the past 10 years have been Clint Eastwood's Million Dollar Baby, Spike Lee's 25th Hour, Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, and the Romanian film 4 months, 3 weeks, and 2 days. My number six pick is also from Europe, from Italy, land of Fellini and Visconti, and some of my favorite movies of all time. This one is called The Best of Youth. It was directed by Marco Tullio Giordana and originally made as a miniseries for Italian television. If you seek it out on DVD, you'll be rewarded by the rich, emotionally absorbing story of a family living through a period of tumultuous change.
Ma che fai truccato la militare?
Ma che truccato? Questo è il militare.
Ma l'università? Non faccio più l'università.
The Best of Youth follows two brothers, Nicola and Matteo Carrati, across 4 decades, from the 1960s to the present era. The whole sweep of recent Italian history is conveyed in 6 hours of swirling, intricate, beautifully acted drama.
Ciao, nonna.
Ciao.
Ciao, zione.
La nonna ha detto ciao, eh? Se piangi ti tiro un cazzotto.
This is a great one, maybe the great movie from any country about the baby boom generation coming of age in a changing world.
Tony, I'm so glad you recommended this. I'm only 2 hours into it, but it is something to absolutely fall into, like people would have in this country to Lonesome Dove.
Yes,
you know,
yes,
it's a family story. You just absolutely feel yourself being pulled into the story.
I have to say, I've forced this movie on a lot of people, saying, you know, you've got to see this six-hour Italian movie, and everyone has thanked me for it.
We're going to show all 6 hours right now.
My number five pick is from Spike Jones. It's a movie Michael and I have talked about a lot in recent weeks. It's Where the Wild Things Are. Jones's moody, pitch-perfect adaptation of the Maurice Sendak classic about a boy named Max who visits an island full of monsters.
That's Alexander.
I hate this tree!
Well, he just wants attention. Don't give him the satisfaction. That's Douglas. I count on him for everything.
We'll take care of each other and we'll all sleep together in a real pile.
I don't think I've ever seen a movie that combined fantasy and realism so seamlessly, or that captured with such wit and sensitivity the volatile emotions of childhood. 10 years from now, I'll be just as wild about this one as I am today.
Now for my list. So far, I picked Minority Report, Gosford Park, Mulholland Drive, United 93, and Zodiac. My number five pick, director Alfonso Cuarón's Y Tu Mama Tambien. The film came out in 2001, and it signaled a fantastic flowering of new Mexican cinema. You can imagine how most directors might have handled a story about two high school seniors off on a road trip with a tantalizing older woman with a secret. Cheap laughs, lots of nudity, sentimental lessons learned. But Cuarón is dealing with complex people and genuine emotions. Diego Luna and Gael Garcia Bernal as the boys from very different social classes. Maribel Verdú as their siren, all excellent. Cuarón went on to make my favorite of the Harry Potter pictures, Prisoner of Azkaban, but Y Tu Mama Tambien remains his most exciting work, I think, and it reminds us all what a coming-of-age movie can be in the right artist's hands.
Yeah, I mean, this movie was such a breath of fresh air and excitement when it came out. It was sexy and it was exciting and it was new. And you're right. I mean, it brought attention to a new generation of Mexican filmmakers, and it seemed to spread across Latin America. I mean, we've seen movies in this decade from Brazil, from Argentina, from Ecuador and Chile. There's a real flowering of Latin American cinema. This was at the vanguard.
And one of the things I really love about it too, seeing it again, Cuarón's mixture of these long takes, but a very kind of loose handheld style, it really gives you a sense of immersion in these stories. And I was really just kind of in love all over again.
Great. Well, I look forward to watching it again.
The end. My number four pick is Once. It's much more unassuming, and the man who made it has described it as a video album about a Dublin street musician and a flower seller destined to harmonize, however fleetingly. Sounds like a nothing, right? Wrong. I love how writer-director John Carney's film takes the oldest cliches in the book and makes them sing, as in this scene where Glenn Hansard and Marqueta Urglova sit down in a music store to find out if they're compatible.
Take this.
That song, Falling Slowly, won an Oscar. Is the movie important? Significant? No. Is it lasting? I think so. Forget the absurd R rating. If your kid or anyone you know is at all interested in music, friendship, a story about two good people trying to do the right thing by their hearts, show them this movie. It is fantastic, I think. What do you think, Tony Scott?
I think it's pretty good.
Wow. ringing endorsement. Good,
sorry.
Good.
I enjoyed it. I think it's charming. I like the two of them. I like the sort of the feel and the looseness and the scruffiness of this movie. The thing that got in my way that didn't let me connect to it the way that you and so many people did. People adore this
movie. Yeah, they love it.
Is that I just don't really like the music all that much. That kind of like, you know, bellowing while you're banging on your acoustic guitar, it just doesn't really work.
I know you tried
me.
That professionally for a while. It didn't work out. I think you're bitter. No.
Yeah, it's my own failure as a busker. So far, my picks are Million Dollar Baby, 25th Hour, Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, 4 months, 3 weeks, and 2 days, The Best of Youth, and Where the Wild Things Are. My number four pick is Roman Polanski's The Pianist. There have been a lot of movies about the Holocaust over the past 10 years, maybe too many. It's become an easy route to seriousness and sentiment, but this one's different. The Pianist is based on the memoir of Vladislav Spielman, a Jewish musician played by Adrian Brody, whose comfortable world is destroyed by the Nazis. Polanski has always been a master of claustrophobic terror, never more so than in the scenes when Spielman, hiding in an empty apartment, watches the war from his windows. Now, Roman Polanski has been in the news a lot lately because of a rape he committed in the 1970s, and I don't believe that his art in any way mitigates his guilt. But I also don't think that the crime diminishes the art, and The Pianist is a great movie, precise, unsparing, and focused on the absurdity and horror of a period in history that still escapes comprehension.
Tony, in the face of The Pianist, I have to retract my pick for Once, because it is so puny compared to Polanski's achievement, which is really fantastic. I mean, for me, it's a more essential and really more piercing film than Schindler's List.
I completely agree.
Yeah, and I just think he's showing you something in a way that really speaks and shows the unspeakable and the unsure.
And it's personal. I mean, he did live through that, you know, as a child in Poland. And it has some of the authority of personal experience and this keen intelligence and insight.
And not a speck of sentiment.
Not at all. Number three pick, Brokeback Mountain. Sometimes a movie's importance can blind you to its other qualities. In 2005, this film was hailed as a breakthrough for its honest depiction of love between men. Coming back to it a few years later, I was struck by the clarity of the storytelling, the sensitivity of the acting, and the sense of detail in Ang Lee's wonderful adaptation of the story by E. Annie Proulx.
If you can't fix it, Jack, you got a standard.
For how long?
As long as we can ride it. There ain't no reins on this one.
This movie will always be remembered, and rightly so, for Heath Ledger's magnificent performance as the taciturn, tormented Ennis Del Mar. But the rest of the cast, Jake Gyllenhaal, Michelle Williams, and Anne Hathaway, are every bit as good. Brokeback Mountain may look like a western, but it's really the great weepy of our time. A swooning love story in the grand Hollywood tradition, rich with the kind of emotion that gives melodrama a good name.
I just can't seem to quit this one.
It's a good film. I think it's a good film. I think Heath Ledger is so unbelievably good in it. And just for the last scene alone, the reunion with his daughter. Yeah. I mean, that's the kind of screen acting you just don't get every generation. My decade's best list so far, Minority Report, Gosford Park, Mulholland Drive, United 93, Zodiac, E2 Mama Tambien, and Once. And my number three pick is Climates. Like the Irish movie Once, this film, which is certainly the least known of my top 10, is about a relationship that is not meant to be. This film is not warm and fuzzy like Once. It is, however, a singularly beautiful work. It was made by the Turkish writer-director Nuri Bilge Ceylan. It's about the end of a long-term affair between an Istanbul university professor and a television art director, and what happens after the end, which is the part most films leave out because it is so uncertain and messy. Early on, during their last vacation together, the woman dreams of happier times. That's Ceylan and his real-life wife, Ebru. Now, the dream, by the way, ends this way. And that's when she knows it's time to call it quits. I will never forget the impact this film had on me the first time I saw it. It's beautiful, and I'm glad this decade project is very simply about the films that meant the most to us personally. That's why I'm telling people to seek out this obscure Turkish import made by a genuine artist. I adore the film.
Yeah, good choice. And Ceylan is much better known around the world. And it's great to, you know, just to remind Americans who tend to have their viewing dominated by Hollywood that there's a world beyond. This is just a lovely movie.
It's my number two pick, Ratatouille. It's my favorite comedy of the decade. And in many ways, it's the most unpredictable of the most recent Pixar gems. Here, Remy, the provincial country rat who dreams of becoming a chef, gets his first look at that magical universe known as Paris.
But why here? Why now?
Why not here? Why not now? What better place to dream than in Paris?
That music by the great Michael Giacchino is enough to make you fly to France immediately. Some people can't get past the whole rat in the kitchen idea with Ratatouille. For me, this is the mastery of Pixar. The director, Brad Bird, who also did The Incredibles, can make me believe in a fairy tale that follows its own seemingly improvised recipe for greatness, and I cannot wait to see this one again. I love it.
I love this movie, too, and it has one of my favorite characters in all of movies of the last decade, and the one that I identify with the most, who is, of course, the critic.
Yes, Anton Ego.
You provide the food, I'll provide the perspective, which would go nicely with a bottle of Cheval Blanc 1947.
For my money, it's the only Pixar film of the last few that actually gets better and better and better and then just ends with this glorious...
It's just great. Yes, it's perfect. Good choice. So far, my picks for the top 10 movies of the decade are Million Dollar Baby, 25th Hour, Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, 4 months, 3 weeks, and 2 days, The Best of Youth, Where the Wild Things Are, The Pianist, and Brokeback Mountain. My number two choice is Steven Spielberg's AI, a project he took over from Stanley Kubrick and perhaps the most misunderstood movie of the past 10 years. AI tells the story of David, played by Haley Joel Osment, a robot ordered up by a childless couple in an ecologically devastated future. David, inspired by the story of Pinocchio, wants to become human.
What were those words for, Mommy?
Like Spielberg's Minority Report, and for that matter, like Avatar, this movie brilliantly fuses CGI and traditional methods to conjure an unsettling and weirdly familiar vision of the future. This movie is long, rich, and strange, and people who complain about a sentimental ending miss the point. This is by far the darkest, saddest movie Spielberg has ever directed. It's about the end of life as we know it, and it remains his unsung masterpiece.
I say it's...
Stop laughing.
Someday I may change my mind on this film, but the more people try to convince me that that ending isn't kind of like teetering into this sentimental, freakly...
human extinction.
No. These two sensibilities, Kubrick's and Spielberg's, did not, I don't think, ultimately make a satisfying mixture.
I think they work together perfectly. Mm-hmm. But we have the next 2,000 years to argue about.
All right.
After 10 years and 5,000 movies, it's time to give our picks for the number one movie of the decade. My choices so far have been Million Dollar Baby, 25th Hour, Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind, 4 months, 3 weeks, and 2 days, The Best of Youth, Where the Wild Things Are, The Pianist, Brokeback Mountain, and AI. Like AI, my pick for the best movie of the decade is the story of a lonely machine who ends up in a world without people. It's WALL-E, the story of a steadfast little robot who falls in love and saves the human race from extinction. The first part of this movie, a virtually wordless tour of the depopulated, trash-strewn planet Earth, is funny, poignant, and downright visionary. And when a sleek new model named Eve shows up, what a lovely love story. This is the finest animation put out under the Pixar label this decade, which is saying an awful lot. And this studio, since 2006, part of the Disney company, has used the newest technology to fulfill the oldest promise of this medium, making movies for everyone. WALL-E may have a chilling, cautionary undertone about our species' self-destructive tendencies, but its warmth, its generosity, and its humor ensure that people will be watching this movie for as long as we care about film.
I agree. It's a gorgeous film. That first half hour, as you mentioned, is as good as I've seen in 10 years in any medium. Yeah. And, you know, I had a little trouble at the end with the action climaxes sort of piling up, as I did with some other Pixar pictures. Yeah. But really, these are small problems in huge achievements. Just great. My decade's best list: Minority Report, Gosford Park, Mulholland Drive, United 93, Zodiac, Y Tu Mama Tambien, Once, Climates, and Ratatouille. And my pick for the best movie of the decade, There Will Be Blood. This most eccentric and haunting of modern epics is driven by oil man Daniel Plainview, who, in the hands of actor Daniel Day-Lewis, becomes a Horatio Alger story gone horribly wrong. Writer-director Paul Thomas Anderson's camera is as crucial to the film's hypnotic pull as the performance at its center.
No matter what the others promise to do, when it comes to the showdown, they won't be there.
For its evocation of the early 1900s, its relentless focus on one man's fascinating obsessions, and for its inspiring example of how to freely adapt a novel, plus what I think is the performance of the new century, There Will Be Blood stands alone.
I abandoned my child.
Say it louder. Say it louder.
I've abandoned my child!
The more I see it, the sadder and stranger and more visually astounding it grows, and the more it seems to say about the best and the worst in the American ethos of rugged individualism. Awfully
Michael.
Good.
I'm drinking your milkshake.
So you agree?
I agree. I mean, for me, the ending still doesn't
that last
quite
half hour.
Work there. The
yeah.
last half
odd,
hour
yes.
is odd and inscrutable, but you're absolutely right. I mean, this character is just one of the great movie characters who has an almost Shakespearean dimension. It's about both the heroism and the monstrosity of American capitalism.
The second time I saw the film, I did find that ending, which leaps into tragic comedy sort of unexpectedly, much easier to take, and now I kind of love it. So.
Well, that one's going to be around for a long time.